We're so happy you're here for this really special event. I have just like a little bit of business to tell you about. We're selling raffle tickets for these beautiful shaker tables that Linda Hirsch made for us. So if you see those and you think you might want them, go ahead and buy a raffle ticket or two. We'll be drawing in 3 weeks. The second thing is we have our brand new CD available for sale, which is the hauntingly gorgeous music, all clarinet chamber music, of Marty Epstein, composer Marty Epstein, a great friend to Winsor Music. So let me tell you a little bit about what you're going to hear this afternoon. We first met Simone Dinnerstein in 2018 after she emailed us because she heard Peggy Pearson's amazing recording of Ich habe genug with Lorraine Hunt Lieberson, Bach, and Peggy invited her to play a concert with Windsor, and we did that in 2018. It was a great success to a sold-out crowd, one of the most memorable events in my musical life, and I think some of you might have been here for that concert. That week, we were having dinner, and she told us about a really remarkable student of hers, someone who was a poet, an artist, a calligrapher, a composer, a pianist, this guy from Afghanistan, Milad Yousufi. He has a remarkable story, some of which you can read about in the program. He grew up in Afghanistan under Taliban rule, where music was completely prohibited. But he dreamed of being a musician so much that he drew piano keys and practiced on the paper. When things eased up there, he ended up going to the only music school in Afghanistan, which was on Kabul, and studied there. Things became too dangerous to stay there, and he applied to be a refugee in the States, and ended up going to the Manus School of Music. Since he's come here, he has not seen his family. That was 7 years ago, and we hope things will be resolved soon. But this piece that you'll hear later on today will tell bits of his story. It's a very moving, compelling piece. The way it came to be was, we were thinking, after hearing his beautiful story, it would be wonderful to work with him, but also for him to get more exposure. And so Winsor spearheaded with Simone a consortium, a commissioning consortium of 10 groups. So this piece will be heard all over the country in the next few years. I wanted to say a bit about the rest of the program. So the first half, you'll hear Simone play Bach and Glass, two composers she's very well known for. And on the second half of the program, you'll hear Milad's piece. And in that piece, you will hear Milad, Simone's student, and also another one of Simone's students, virtuoso pianist prodigy, 19-year-old Emma Taggart. I think this whole program really embodies a lot of what Winsor really believes in: mentorship, healing through music, compassion. I think it's a very, you'll find it a very moving experience. I'll say a few words about the Bach. Simone asked amazing composer Alan Fletcher, who is head of the Aspen Music Festival and also former faculty at NEC, also helped run NEC as dean and I believe provost. And so he has a Boston connection, and she asked him to write an arrangement for her and Peggy of some Bach. And these arrangements turned out so beautifully. They also lend themselves to further expansion. So Gabby and I will also be joining in on some of the other pieces, and I think you'll really enjoy them. I'll remind you to turn off your cell phones, and we can get started. Thank you again for being here.
Thank you. we're just so moved that you did this for us, so thank you very much.
Thank you.
Gabriela Diaz, co-artistic director of Windsor Music. And before we continue on with the program, we just wanted to take a minute to thank our incredible operations manager, Stephen, who is retiring at the end of this season. Stephen, do you want to come up? She gave us an incredible piece, and when we were asking her to write the song for the spirit, that was the beginning of the pandemic time. So she chose the Hippocratic Oath as her text. So that's what you'll see as the text in the program. And so how this works is that we will teach it to you by playing it for you once. we'll play through the piece once, just instrumental. You'll always hear me playing the melody. Also, Simone will be playing the melody, and Peggy will be at the end, so you can follow along the melody that way. And then we'll invite you to all sing with us the second time.
Thank you.
in order. So meeting Simone will come before farewell Kabul. So when you're following along with the text, just those last two will be flip-flopped. Also in your program, you'll find a list of places to donate to, which we've had the help of a lawyer who's been relocating Afghan refugees here in America, and he helped us find the organizations that he thought would be most helpful if you're interested in donating. And also, our last concert of the season will be a week from Monday, on Monday the 23rd, at the Unitarian Society in Winchester, and that will be our concert to benefit Ukrainian musicians, and all of the proceeds from that concert will go straight to a fund that is particularly for Ukrainian musicians who've been so displaced during this time. So we hope you might be able to join us next Monday as well. Thank you for coming.
My journey to America, my birthright. I was born on June 6, 1995, during the darkest days of the Civil War in Afghanistan and Kabul, Afghanistan's capital city. The circumstances of my birth were quite memorable. I know this because for years after, my father would tell me about the night I came into the world. At that time, the war was not far away. The sound of bombs and gunfire were familiar to everywhere and everyone who lived in Kabul, and that was no exception. My mother woke my father at midnight. She was going into labor. It was time. During those days, there was no electricity at all in Kabul. Everywhere was dark, with no closed relatives nearby. My parents had no choice but to leave my older brother, then 2 years old, alone, and sleep in his bed. I believe it was my mother who placed a lamp next to his pillow so that he would not be threatened if he woke. Thankfully, he did not wake, and the kerosene lamp safely burned itself out by morning. Having left the lamp, my father helped my mother walk from my brother's bedroom to the backyard, and they were on their way to the hospital. Their means of transport was the only one available, the bicycle. My mother balanced on the seat and my father armed with a length of pipe for protection. Set off along the dark, deserted streets, the hospital was 5 miles away. Only minutes after setting off, my parents pedaled into a pack of street dogs. Here, when we think of dogs, we think of pets, but in Kabul, there are very few pets, dogs. Instead, there were wild dogs, street dogs, and many of them were running. At first, my father tried to outrun them, but the faster he rode, the more they chased. Realizing that this was a race he could not win, my father got off the bike and beat the ground with his pipe. The dog retreated, but only a short distance. In his telling of the story, he had to repeat this act every several hundred yards until he and my mother reached the hospital. That 5 mile bike ride took 2 hours. Around an hour after they arrived at the hospital, I was born. My parents waited for the sun to rise and for the lull and the gunfire before they took the return journey. They went by cab, and apparently on that ride home, I attempted to eat my mother's meal. I was hungry.
Thank you.
My earliest memories are from the worst days of the war, but in those dark times, neighbors became family. However, you were a family that was dwindling, one by one. Families would leave, looking for safety in Iran or Pakistan. The wealthy would go to Europe. Slowly, life became more lonely. Departures happened monthly, but the worst departure was the departure that was permanent. A friend of mine left one last time from playing in our yard to visit a relative in a village outside of Kabul. That afternoon, he stepped on a mine and lost his life. It was shocking for all of us, childhood friends, but we could do nothing but pray for him. Thank you. my father, I had a wonderful father. He was tall, handsome, and serious. A very dignified person among his friends and colleagues. From our childhood, my brother and I did our best to make our father proud. He had great hopes for both of us. As a young man, my father had wanted to become a musician, but my grandfather would not allow it. When he discovered my interest in art and music, my father did everything he could to support me. For both myself and my brother, he was our model and our support. He left us too soon. My father passed away unexpectedly from a brain tumor. With him gone, my brother and I took on responsibility of supporting our family. We needed his example to do this, to remember his strength and courage. Still, I cannot believe that he is gone. If I close my eyes, I can see him standing, smiling at me in his dark blue suit. mosquito. There were some happy times that I can never forget from when I was 3 or 4 years of age, during the Civil War. Kabul was in turmoil, but those happy moments were engraved in my heart with gold forever. Here are two. My father made sure that we all slept comfortably during the many summer nights when there was no electricity. He would sit by our beds and cool me and my siblings by waving an old fan, doing it until we fell asleep. It was hard to sleep in the heat, and I cannot imagine that he slept more than 2 or 3 hours a night. Once he had provided a cool breeze for us to sleep in, if I close my eyes, I can still hear the sound of him fanning it. But before we went to bed was the most memorable prayer. The heat was bad, but the mosquitoes were worse. So our pre-bed ritual included through mosquito hunting. My father would put me up on his shoulders and we would go around the house hounding mosquitoes with our red flies swarming. It was joyful teamwork. I would show my father mosquitoes that were hiding on top of our cabinets. Some of them I named actual mosquitoes. Since they played the dead game by remaining completely still, then flying away when we had passed, I would play out to them and catch them in flight, setting tall and powerful on my father's shoulders, armed with a crimson glass sword. It is still one of my most vivid memories from wartime. Looking back, I realized that my father must have hated the mosquitoes as much as I did. Is an old house, my heart, my mother lived there. I beg you to touch her feet. Tell her I will come home one day. Tell her I will come home. Oh, westerly winds, I beg you do me a favor. Go to my village. Pass my greetings to the grave of my beloved ones. My heart is burning like a flame and broken into pieces far from my heart. I will go home where my beloved cared for me. I will go home one day. I will go home. What a soul, what a heart like the universe. My love for my mother began the first day I was born, the day I attempted to eat her veil in the cab on our way home. Whenever I'm facing a calamity, I go to my mom. If I'm close to her, I can face the world. But if I'm away from her, I feel the weakest and loneliest in the crowd. When I feel guilty, I go to my mom. If she forgives me, I have a feeling that God has also forgiven me. If she's absent, I have nowhere to go. I feel that God is also absent. My mom is my connection to God's kindness. Whenever I was scared of the world, I would hide behind my mom and press my eyes into her shoulder like a cat. My mother is far away in India. How can I believe that she's away from me? How can I believe that I am still living? How can I believe that my heart is still beating? A child asked his mother, "Why did you put paradise under your feet?" The mother replies, "I wanted to keep it close, my son." 16, and my lawyer had been helping me establish a life in America. Knowing that I was a musician, she had connected with every musician she knew, and one of them was the dean of the Manchester School of Music. The Manchester School offered me a full scholarship, and knowing that I was a painter as well as a musician, they invited me to audition for Simone Dinnerstein, whose father is a wonderful painter. I still remember the first day I played for Simone. To support myself in America and to send money to my family in Afghanistan, I had been working for 40 hours a week at a fast food restaurant in Brooklyn. All of that meant that I had not touched the piano in a year. As I played for her, my hands felt frozen and my body felt stiff. Something magical happened. Someone responded to my playing and took me as a pupil. Not only did she give me hope and self-belief as a musician, but she gave me a family. Although I have been blessed in so many ways, my journey from the bicycle in Cabo to Brooklyn in 2019 has involved much loss and separation. So many people have helped me heal. I have been cycling 30 miles a day to reach my basement room in Flushing. Simone found me a home near her with a couple who loved and cared for me. She made sure I had time to practice. She showered me with warmth, love, hope, and care. She helped me become an artist whose piece were played in Boston Symphony Hall and New York's Carnegie. If I were to write a book about Mr. Dinnerstein's kindness and warmth, it could not be longer. I always repeat this in my mind. I was born to a Muslim family, adopted by a Jew, fed by a Christian, accompanied by a Buddhist, and loved by a Hindu. That is what I call love. That is what I call humanity. decided to seek asylum in the United States, I realized that I would not be able to see my country anytime soon. I felt abandoned by my home, and yet I longed to go back to it. I wanted to express these conflicted feelings, so I wrote a piece called Farewell Calling. I tried to express both my sorrow and my loss, and the beautiful memories which I kept with me from Calling. There are moments in creating a piece of art where I do not know how it was created, this piece of memory. It transports me to the past and a thousand wonderful